Emirates Airlines flew us direct from Manchester to Dubai, where we spent overnight in a crummy hotel before joining the quest for our 11-night Arabian cruise. Quest is berthed within sight of the venerable old QE2, now permanently moored in Dubai as a hotel. We had a full day in Dubai, and we got a taxi to visit the Dubai Mall. This is one of the largest shopping malls in the world, and is home to the large Dubai Aquarium. Even without going into the aquarium, you get to see some spectacular fish just through the aquarium wall. It's almost Christmas, and Swarovski have created what might well be the world's most expensive Christmas tree on their stall. Neighbour to the Mall is the Burj Khalifa, still the world's tallest building. Overnight, Quest sails for Doha, the capital of the small state of Qatar. We've booked a ship's tour of the city, and our first stop is near the docks where the traditional boats are berthed. We also have a view of the Museum of Islamic Art, which we will be visiting later. Doha's modern skyline is not as high-rise as Dubai. Next stop is Qatara Cultural Village, which was built to foster intercultural understanding. These are traditional Qatari pigeon towers. The Qatara Mosque. The Arabic-influenced Roman amphitheatre holds 5,000 people. Pictures of the Emir of Qatar are everywhere. Our next stop is the Pearl, a residential development where foreigners are allowed to buy property, which is unique in Qatar. The development also includes high-end shops, restaurants, and marinas. Time to head off for the souk. Over the road from the souk is the Islamic Cultural Centre. The souk was rebuilt in 2008 following the destruction of most of the old buildings by fire. Thank you. more pictures of the Sheikh and his ancestors. There's a falcon souk where you can buy real live falcons and everything else you need to engage in the traditional pastime of falconry. Nearby are the camels of the Qatari police force, where they can hang out when they're not needed for ceremonial duties. Back to the Old Port for our visit to the Museum of Islamic Art. The museum was designed by the Chinese-American architect I.M. Pei when he was well into his 90s. The collection spans the entire Islamic world geographically and 1400 years in time. Next morning, we arrive at Sir Banias Island, which is part of the Emirate of Abu Dhabi. The island contains three resort hotels and a wildlife park, and also welcomes cruise ship passengers. We booked a tour of the island through the ship, and our first stop is at a sort of lodge built by the Emir originally so he could hold meetings. Our next stop is an archaeological site uncovered in the 1990s. It's a Christian monastery dating from the 7th century. Next, it's the wildlife park. Most of the species here are not native to the region. These are Barbary sheep from North Africa. Arabian oryx. Arabian antelope. Some of these animals provide the food for the island's carnivores, including cheetahs. Time to head back to the ship. Our next stop is Abu Dhabi City, the capital not only of the Emirate of Abu Dhabi, but of the United Arab Emirates as a whole. Our first stop is Yas Island, a man-made island which includes a Formula One race circuit, many theme parks and hotels, and top-end restaurants and so on. Next, the Sultan Zayed Mosque, which holds 40,000 worshippers. Across the road from the mosque is the National War Memorial. Back to the waterfront, and that is the Crown Prince's Palace. We have another day at sea before we arrive in Muscat, the capital of Oman, where we will be for 2 days. We're on a full day trip to Nizwa to see forts and castles. But first we have the compulsory visit to the souks, which seem to be quite modern. Not a shop you're likely to find where we live. Nizwa Fort dates from the 12th century, but the bulk of what we can see today was built in the mid-19th century. From the parapets, there's a view of the old town. It's a half-hour drive to Jibreen Castle. This was built in the late 17th century, primarily as a palace for the Sultan. This was a room for storing dates. Jibreen is apparently the most visited castle in Oman. Our second day, we just take a stroll round Muscat. The souk. There's Quest in the harbour, and nearby, the Sultan's two private yachts. We set sail early evening for 2 days at sea, Christmas Day and Boxing Day, and on Boxing Day there is an eclipse of the sun, an annular eclipse. Our route won't take us directly under the path of totality, so we don't get to see the fiery ring. Nevertheless, it was a rare and quite spectacular sight. The crew ensured that we were fully prepared for the viewing experience. We arrive in Mumbai on a very murky morning. We've booked a ship's tour to the caves on Elephanta Island, and we'll board our ferry by the Gateway of India near the Taj Hotel. The ride takes about half an hour, and the ferry has rather primitive facilities. The island, when we arrive, is quite chaotic, with lots of monkeys everywhere, which are quite a pest. A rickety toy town train takes us along the jetty, and then there's an incredibly steep walk to the top. When we arrive at the top, though, the main cave is certainly worth the effort. Carved out of the rock by hand, they were probably completed no later than the middle of the 6th century AD. The other cave we went to see is a lot simpler, possibly more like monastic cells. Back down to the jetty on the Toy Town train, and then return to our ferry, back to the Gateway of India, back to the ship, and then the next day home with Emirates Airways via Dubai.